Welcome to another edition of the Bodybuilding Legend Show. I'm your host, John Hansen, and I'm broadcasting live from the Powerhouse Gym in downtown Tampa, Florida. On today's show, we are going to have part two of our interview with Mike Quinn. Mike's going to talk about his experiences competing in the Mr. Olympia contest. Mike competed in the Mr. Olympia contest from 1988 through 1990, and then he went on to compete in the newly formed WBF contest that Vince McMahon formed. And Mike was actually one of the people that convinced Vince to start the WBF. And then Mike competed in that organization for 2 years, 1991, 1992. And then finally, Mike made his comeback to the IFBB, competing in the Night of the Champions contest in 1993 and in 1994. If you saw part one of our interview with Mike Quinn, you saw how honest and open he was with everything regarding bodybuilding, the drug usage, the difficulties he went through being bipolar and having the different and being manic depressive and having the issues that he had. And he also talks about the different personalities in the sport, the ones he had problems with. So it's going to be another interesting interview with Mike Quinn. So we're going to hear from our sponsors, and we'll be right back with our interview with Mike Quinn on the Bodybuilding Legend Show. We'll be right back. Check out NFE All Natural Warrior Supplements, featuring pure isolate protein made with natural stevia flavor, 1 gram of sugar and no fat. NFE Trim, thermogenic fat burner, boosts your metabolism, suppress your appetite, build strength, develop muscle, and shed that body fat. Go to NFE.com today.
NFE stands for No Freaking Excuses.
I started training with Robbie Robinson in January 88, you know, we trained for the LA Grand Prix, and at that time it was the Pro World. It wasn't the Classic yet,
right.
And, you know, I killed Robbie, and he looked so amazing. And finally, my girl said to me at the time, "You're going to stop training with Robbie. You're making him better than you." I was like, I idolized him, so I didn't care. I didn't care if he beat me. Well, that's not the attitude to have, you know. But, you know, I didn't know I was building myself to be a legend like Robbie, you know. I mean, when people say that I'm a legend, I have a hard time wrapping my mind around that.
Yeah.
I don't think like that, you know. I was a good athlete, and I just worked harder than everybody else, you know. I deserved to win a pro show, but never did.
Mm-hmm.
But it's okay. I used to, you go to a show and you get a standing ovation when you pose and everybody else barely gets any claps. You sit back and go, man, what's wrong with this?
Right.
And, you know, but got used to being basically fucked. And, you know, for the 88 Olympia, I didn't train with Robbie. And I would do it the same way. Yeah, I'll be honest with you. I'm training people now. Everything's old school, John. I'm not none of this new contemporary shit. I'm not using anything.
Yeah.
I'm doing exactly what I did to get into condition, and my people are coming in shape. You know, I got a girl competing this Saturday, and she's unreal. I mean, phenomenal athlete. And
right.
That's my thing now is to be teaching people, you know.
Yeah, and that's a good place to go.
Well, I'm responsible to my guys' health, though. You know, I make them get blood work, and you know, I don't let them take high dosages and not a lot of drugs. Right. You know, I push hardcore training on them and the nutrition first. And you know, taking steroids only allows you to do one and two harder. You know, taking drugs allows you to eat more protein, so you can convert into nitrogen. In turn, you're training heavier, so you're building more muscle and you're getting bigger. Yeah. Okay, but that's not like it anymore. Joey, I got to tell you, we, in our era, we didn't take insulin. I mean, you know, I never heard of anybody taking insulin in my era.
Or GH,
you know,
either, right, Mike? Were they taking GH in the 80s?
Yeah, yeah, that was for sure. I didn't. Yeah. I did my first cycle at GH in 89.
89, but, okay.
Yeah, but, yeah, you know, I'm glad they're trying to go back to the shredded look.
Yeah.
I mean, but the judges have to do it at these shows.
Right.
They got to be willing to say, you know what, you're too big. We need you to be in condition. They have to put condition first now in shows if they want to keep bodybuilding alive.
Yeah.
But you know, John, you know we're not going to see this. We've already talked. I mean, fitness is taking over, and it's, you know, fitness is mainstream.
Yeah.
And bodybuilding is never going to be. So
right.
It's sad. It's kind of sad, you know, because this was, you know, this is what built my life. Yeah, and it made me proud of what I did. You know, John, back home in my whole town, I'm in state legislature with Rocky Marciano and Marvin Hagler. We're in front of Home of the Champions.
Really?
And yeah, I'm in legislature with Rocky Marciano and Marvin Hagler. It's amazing.
That's great.
And that happened in 97. I'm already retired, you know?
Yeah.
I have some awesome accolades. You know, I'm so famous in my city. You know, it makes me proud. You know, it really does. You have no idea, you know, how proud it is when your city is, like, so behind you and so supportive. And they liked I put bodybuilding on the map for my city, you know.
That was Brockton, Massachusetts, right, Mike?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Brockton was a hardcore town, produced a lot of athletes. I mean, I grew up with Marky Marciano's family.
Really?
And I went to school with Marvin Hagler's younger brother. Yeah, and I knew, you know, of course I didn't know Rocky. I was, you know, when he died, I was not even born, but.
Yeah.
I mean, I personally know Marvin, you know, and, you know, great champion.
Yeah.
I love Marvin. Yeah. It just to be, you know, to be in the same sentence as those two guys. You got to pinch yourself, you know.
Absolutely.
It's like, oh, my God, is this, wow, you know. All I can say is wow, you know. And, you know, it was a big newspaper article on it when it came out, and it was on best accolade I think I've ever had of any titles or anything to be associated with them. You know, that was huge.
Let's go back to 88, Mike, when you did that Olympia, because that was your first Olympia, and that was probably one of your best conditions ever on stage.
Oh, ever.
After that Pro World, did you make the decision that you wanted to come in a lot more ripped for the Olympia?
Well, first off, my girl convinced me that you can't train with Robbie.
Okay,
that was it. So I trained with Paul Fetters again. You know, Paul knew me and knew how much I could handle.
Yeah.
And he would give me beatings like my old man used to give me. You know, just you train to the point of getting sick, you know, and that's all I ever knew. And again, Rick, we put together an amazing posing routine then. I mean, it was awesome. And
yeah, your posing routine used different music from different songs, and you put them together, which was pretty unique for that time.
Well, the hardest thing is getting my poses were right to a beat, and if I missed the beat, the whole routine was gone.
Right.
That used to give me anxiety. Right before I'd go on stage, I'd be like, oh my God, I can't remember nothing, you know? And because you've done the routine so many times with the music, was what would, you know, dial me back in so I wasn't losing my mind.
Right.
Oli viides ammattilaisten MM-kisoissa. Mike Panevahan. Pazda, kuusikko, että pääsin yleisöön. Tekan rakentavalla kosata suomalaisen.
I'll be back.
You know what, John? You know why I did so well that year? They didn't even have me in the top 10, you know, as being a contender.
Right.
And I remember going, oh, really? All right, we're going to take this body to a whole new level. And, you know, at that time, I hired a chemist. And, you know, it wasn't – the dosages weren't high, but the drugs were just that strong. Mm-hmm. You know, that pulled on to a lot of muscle tissue while I dialed down and got that ripped. Oh, don't get me wrong. I think I lost muscle to get that shredded.
Yeah.
But, you know, there was no fat anywhere, John. I weighed in at 204 pounds.
I know. I remember that.
I mean, come on. That's unheard of. And to look the way I look, people are like, you know what? And I came back to the night show about 209 because I drank, you know, and I ate.
Right.
And
now, what was your training like for that, Mike? How much cardio were you doing? How much, you know, what was your diet like and stuff?
Well, I was doing... You know, like I said, my fiance at the time, you know, convinced me to do a low carb diets. Kind of, I did a rotation, 3 days low, one day, you know, eat back up.
Uh-huh.
I didn't know about low carbs, but my girl did, and when she convinced me to do it, that's how I turned pro. So I just stuck with the formulation, but training was hardcore, John. Never, when I was getting ready for a show, I was like, do not fuck with me. Mm-hmm. Don't fuck with my eating patterns. Don't fuck with me getting to the gym on time. Especially don't try to take a piece of equipment I'm using away from me. You know, I mean, I was psychotic a little bit, John.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was clinically kind of crazy, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, I take like 4 medications right now just to be stable like I am now. Not that I'm saying I'm so stable now.
Did you have any run-ins with any of the guys at the gym back then? Because I think everybody was training at Gold's back then, right? Back in 88 for that Olympia in L.A.?
Yeah. And, you know, I went after Mike Christian. But, you know, we're friends now, you know. And the only guy I would have had a really hard time with was Jimmy Quinn. Mm-hmm. Jimmy was prepping for the USA in the gym I trained at. And once you get into that low-carb thing, wow, the drugs make you crazy. I mean, you are really, like, on edge. Mm-hmm. I mean, way on edge. Like, things that bother me shouldn't have bothered me at all.
Right.
But it would set me off. And I remember Jimmy, you know, there's a word. It's called, you know, when you eye-fuck somebody. You don't say anything, no words, but you can tell when somebody's looking at you with bad intentions.
Right.
So, you know, Jimmy's, like, looking at me like that every day. And I remember it's, like, 4 weeks out from the show. And Jimmy's bigger than me. And I remember, you know, walking in one day and here he was giving me dirty looks. I was like, you know what? Fuck this. And I said, Jimmy, let's go outside, man. You got a fucking hat on for me. Let's go. And it changed his demeanor towards me. You know, we're not playing football, so that demeanor does not belong anywhere.
Right.
You know, and that's the thing. You know, all he did was show me that, you know, people were afraid of me competing against me. That's all it says. Come on. We're not making a basket. We're not doing, you know, scoring a goal or, you know, right. A field goal or whatever. This is what you look like, you know. So I never feared anybody.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody. I didn't care who you were. If you didn't beat me in the gym, how are you beating me on stage? You know, it made zero sense. Because in the real world, real athletes that train the hardest win, mm-hmm. you know. But, no, that's not for bodybuilding. It's not like that. It's never been like that. But – I'm proud of it.
What about Stridham? Didn't you guys have a little?
Yeah, we just had it out again, and yeah, man, he thinks he can actually handle me. You know, I mean, the guy's never been in a fight in his whole life. I mean, his thing beat up women, and why is he in Thailand? You know, he likes little boys and little girls, dude. This is everybody knows this. Well, everybody knows now, but yeah, man, you know, we got into it. I don't know, 2 months ago, he said that he was drug-free for the WBF. I was like, what? When he said that, I was like, what? I was like, what the fuck are you talking about, drug free? And I remember telling him, I said, Gary, I don't even think fucking Vince tested him. You know, and that's how much ahead of him he was. How's he so much ahead of us, and we're just barely, we look like shit.
Right.
Face it, 91 and 92, I look like shit because I didn't take fucking drugs. Vince had a hot on for me, you know. He was going to make sure he'd straighten me out. Well, straighten shit out. You know, he wasn't doing anything. It figures because my best friend in wrestling was Hawk, you know. Hawk and Animal were my best friends. So I had that mentality, you know. And now he wasn't able to do it, you know, even though he drug tested me 7 times before the last one, 92. And I passed every test and got to the show and ended up getting almost dying. Going to the show, I took a diuretic. And a diuretic can either work very well and you just use subcutaneous water, or it's going to pull out other things, you know. And it makes you physically sick. You vomit. And I'm on stage and I just started throwing up.
Wow.
So immediately they rushed me to the hospital, you know. My blood pressure is like, I don't know, 80 over 40. I mean, my resting heart rate was like over 200. You know, I was about to, basically, I guess my heart was about to blow up, you know? Mm-hmm. But listen to this. They take me to the hospital. So now they've got I got IVs in both arms. And there's a point where the body has to adjust. And every, you know, it's starting to take in the minerals. But there's a point where the body just cramps. And it was horrible. I mean, my mom's crying. My dad's got one foot stretching out. I mean, my mom's got the other foot stretching me out. My abdomen went up inside of me. You know, physically crumbled and went up inside. Wow. Like a deep tap. And I was in tears probably for 20 minutes. I mean, that was horrible. But you know what I did? I went right back to the show. Had 5 minutes. I put my all on and went out and did my routine.
Really?
I didn't back out. I was like, forget it. I've done this. I'm going to do it. So, I'm extreme when it comes to that. You know, if I'm not competing, I've got to have, you know, a major stitches somewhere where I've, you know, broken a bone.
Yeah.
You know, because I just knew I owed it to the fans, not the promoters.
Right.
Promoters always wanted me in their show, but I was there for the fans.
Right.
Always. They always came first, and as long as they were happy, I did my job. The rest to me was just a bunch of bullshit. You know, they didn't like that about me because I did what I wanted to. You know, I said what I wanted to say, you know. And I can't believe to this day now they're not saying it, you know. Mm-hmm. Like nobody's being honest about what they're taking and what they're experimenting with. And, you know, honestly, I go online and these cycles these guys are taking, John, they're taking as much in 1 week that I used to take in 6 weeks.
Wow.
A cycle for a show. I mean, it's just unheard of. Between 2,000 and 5,000 milligrams a week of just testosterone.
Right.
Forget all the rest. Forget insulin. Forget growth. You know, and, you know, also, I don't know how many guys are using EPO. You know, remember what Lance Armstrong got busted for?
Yeah,
I used it in 94. I got on stage. That was my last pro show, 94. I got on stage. I weighed 252 pounds, shredded. I mean, it made me grow overnight, John, but it scared me. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that's what gave me a heart problem because I did in 94, and 10 years later, my arteries were almost completely closed.
So how would that make you grow, Mike? Tell me about that, EPO. I don't understand that.
Well, Epigen, they give it to cancer patients because, you know, your red blood cells get destroyed with the cancer.
Okay.
So it triples your red blood cell count. So what that says is it's 3 times the amount of oxygen in your bloodstream that's going to make you grow. You know, you're not growing at 1-on-1. Now you're 3-to-1 growth ratio.
Right.
And it just makes the drugs work better. And, I mean, it freaked me out, John, to be honest with you. Wow. It really did freak me out.
Let's go back to 88, Mike. We sort of lost our train of thought there.
Okay.
What'd you think of that show going in there? Obviously, you thought Lee Haney was going to win. But when you started getting in the call-outs at the pre-judging, how did you feel it was going?
Well, you know, they didn't call me out to the seventh round.
Okay.
before they even called me out. And that was because of Jim Mannion. You know, Jim Mannion pulled me out. And that's the first call I got pulled out, I got moved up and compared to everybody after that.
Yeah.
And, you know, I got six, but should have been higher. There's no doubt. A picture says 1,000 words. Watch the video and look at pictures. My body is superb. And I was in incredible shape, you know. And, you know, the only thing I remember, what made me think so much of 80 Olympia is I had to stand next to Lee Haney in the lineup.
Mm-hmm.
And just remembering how big his toes were. Can you believe that's the only real hard memory I have is how big Lee Haney's, you know, feet and toes were?
Yeah.
And that's kind of crazy, right, the things you think about. But
That's one of my favorite Olympias. I think everybody was in – a lot of people were in shape for that show, and everybody was in condition. The posing routines were excellent. It just seemed like an amazing show.
Come on. The top 15 guys were
– Yeah.
Today, all go, you know, top five in any show.
Yeah.
Just alone because of conditioning. And we had size.
Yep.
I mean, we had Eduardo Kowak, who's the biggest guy I've ever seen at 5'8".
Yeah.
You remember him?
Yeah, yeah, well, sure.
He just recently passed away.
Yep.
I mean, a lot of my guys from my era are dying. You know?
That was just a great show, though, because like I remember Peter Augustus wrote an article, and he said that was his favorite Olympia ever. And I got to agree with him, man. It was like you guys all looked like superheroes. You all looked amazing.
Yeah, you know, when we all were – I knew we were friends. Even though we had this hostility going on, and even though, you know, I had a problem with Stridham, I was friends pretty – you're friends with them, kind of, you know. It's just your competitive. I mean, now years later, I'm friends with everybody.
Yeah.
Except, you know, Stridham and me don't get along because I don't think he's shit. You know, he's not a legend.
Mm-hmm.
He's never competed against the best guys in bodybuilding. He never did that. I did.
Yeah.
So it's not even a comparison. All you get goes on, well, I'm laughing all the way to the bank. Yeah, well, you're living in Thailand, and that's, like, pretty disgusting what you're doing. You know, mm-hmm. But, hey, fuck him. You know, he's –
Then after that Olympia, you guys did a bunch of Grand Prix. You did that Grand Prix tour, right?
Yeah, I mean, Stridham didn't do it.
Yeah.
Because, he would have got beat by me.
You and Barry DeMay and Lee Labrada, Rich Ascari.
See, you know, Lee Haney went to the first Grand Prix, and that was over. He started touring in Europe after that.
But, yeah.
Yeah, I was top five with every Grand Prix. Like I said, me and Brian Buchanan went from fourth to fifth, back and forth.
Right.
The whole Grand Prix. There was 9 shows, I think.
Wow. Yeah.
Okay. I got to tell you, John, that's the hardest thing I've ever done.
Yeah, it's got to be tough.
Hold my peak for that long. So, you know, you compete in a show, and that night they'd have a banquet, and you just eat as much food as you could, you know, travel to the next site. And
some of those shows weren't even a week apart, right, Mike? They were only like four or five days apart.
It was 2 shows in a weekend.
Wow.
Okay. Sunday and Sunday, okay? But, you know, you'd have, you know, we went to the Olympia and then the Grand Prix, and then we had, you know, 5 days to, you know, prep for the next Grand Prix on a Saturday, you know. So, you know, I'd eat my face off, and then Monday just drop my carbs again and re-peak. But the dangerous thing was, you know, the most dangerous thing wasn't the steroids. It was, you know, taking amphetamines every day because you were never adjusted to the time you're on.
Mm.
You know, you never felt good. So I would take an amphetamine every day. I mean, it was called fasting. And it worked good. And the only thing that was bad is I took a medication called Halcyon to sleep at night.
Because
on low carbs, you can't sleep, you know. And, you know, I did that. I think that was more detrimental than anything. If you know anything about Halcyon, people have committed murder on it.
Really?
You know, gotten out of their bed sleepwalking and kill people.
Yeah.
Never do it. So that was an extremely dangerous drug. But, John, the hardest thing, brother, I'm telling you, it was so hard to peak for every show.
Yeah.
I did. But I think putting your body through that, every time you do that, you know, you lose your ability to get better.
Mm-hmm.
At that point, you need a lot of time off. And at that point, I wasn't taking time off because I was in a match. I was getting work. And every promoter would beg me to go on their shows because I was a draw.
Yeah.
You know, put me on the flyer that I'm competing, they would sell out.
That's what I was going to say after that sixth place. Go ahead.
You never knew what I was going to do.
Yeah.
I never knew what I was going to do, John. I mean, I was so unpredictable with myself. I mean, things would come out of my mouth, and I'd go, wow, did I really just say that? But, yeah, you know, it was crazy. It was crazy.
Well, your career had to take off after that sixth place at the Olympia, right?
You had it did, but you know what? Another bad thing that the Weeders were doing. All right, now I'm doing appearances and guest posings, and I heard about 10 times in my career, wow, you're nothing like people say you are, you know. The Weeders at the time were telling promoters that I was hard to work with. Because the next thing for me was to let me get powerful through making a lot of money, okay? And they made sure that I didn't make a shitload of money. My first year pro, I only made 80 grand. Hmm. And I worked my ass off, you know. And then I think the second year I made about the same. And almost, because then my sister committed suicide in 89 and it was over. It was over for me at that point. I mean, I was way too heartbroken to even try to do a show. Yeah. It took me 5 years to get back on stage. I got back on stage in 94. But, you know, that's after self-medicating myself, you know, to death, trying to anyways. You know, I had a couple unsuccessful suicides. I kept waking up, you know. Hmm. But, you know, I had a nervous breakdown because, you know, I was under so much pressure to compete and, you know, do exhibitions and get my face out there that it was too much at one time. You know, I had to learn from strangers in Germany that my sister just died, you know, and I fell apart, dude. Yeah, I came home and drank and did so much drugs, I just did not want to be alive anymore.
Wow.
And I kept waking up. So, you know what? I was like, you know what? I'm so type A, but I would self-medicate. Because of ADHD and the bipolar, I was always self-medicating. You know, so, you know, I developed a drug problem along with the mental illness. I was self-medicating so I could feel better. But, you know, you never feel better. Because when you wake up, you're right back to that same feeling that is just, you know, ripping your heart out.
Your sister committed suicide before that 89 Olympia, Mike? Is that when it was? Or?
Yeah, it was April. And, May.
May?
Yeah, and...
You still went ahead and did the show.
Well, I only had 7 weeks. I went to rehab and had 7 weeks to prepare for the show.
Uh-huh.
And I went from fat and over out of shape to placing seventh.
Yeah, you look good in that show.
But, yeah, it was... But you know what? I watch it now and you can see in my eyes I'm not there.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not there. I'm somewhere else and I'm just trying to feel better. And, right. You know, I didn't feel better.
This year with preparing for the show, emotionally was the hardest show I've ever prepared for in my life. 4 months ago, my little sister died. And probably was the most devastating thing that have ever happened in my life. And it took, actually the field, the people in the field were really what brought me back. I mean, the support I got from just the people in the sport to keep going on. You know, I didn't even want to train anymore. So mainly I'm doing this in memory of her and wherever she is, I want to know how much I loved her.
understand.
Still went to the Grand Prix circuit after that, mm-hmm. and placed top five in most of the shows. But you know, it was over. When your heart is broken, you have no passion left.
Yeah,
you know, there was nothing left for me to do.
Right, right.
Go ahead.
I was just gonna say, in '90, they did. That's when they did the drug testing at the Olympia. And how did you feel about that?
John, 26, 27 guys went in the show.
Right.
And I didn't take any drugs. You could tell by looking at me. Mm-hmm. And that was my favorite routine to do, even though I was kind of skinny.
Woo!
14 guys failed the test.
Yeah.
You know, even Barry DeMay did. I was like, wow. And, you know, we all look bad, dude. I almost thought that Lee Lombardo was going to be Lee Haney that year.
Yeah.
Just because his conditioning was better, but, you know, that wasn't going to happen. You know, it's hard to take down the Mr. Olympia. You know, yeah. once they're there usually as long as they want. I mean, and,
now, when you went in that show, Mike, did you just get off? Because I think some guys might have taken some stuff to mask the drugs, or they got off them at a certain time, but you just went off totally, right?
Yeah, but, you know, I went off because I knew they would speculate hard on me. Mm-hmm. But, John, I'm living in Florida. Everybody's on the West Coast. They have all these secrets. I didn't know anything.
Yeah.
You know, I knew it was taking steroids and dieting for shows. Right. I didn't know masking this and doing that.
Right.
So, you know, I had to be natural. But what a joke. I mean, Mauro DiPasquale put me on that high-fat diet. What a joke, John. I mean, I was running, physically running twice a day and doing two workouts. And wow. I showed up like a pig, you know. High fat, high protein. Well, in theory, it works if you're an O blood type, but I wasn't. I was an A blood type. Yeah. So my body responded to high complex carbs, moderate protein, low fats. You know, so that diet destroyed me. You know, plus I'm drug free for it. I look bad. I mean, I paid a big price to look that bad too for years.
Yeah.
About aggression. People are afraid of aggression, but they're drawn to me. No matter how afraid they are of Mike Quinn, there's still something about me that, like, wow, you know, there's a certain energy there. My goal was that, you know, even when I go on stage now, it's like, I go out there, you know, okay, I'm there for to compete, but I go out there for the fans, you know. If they go off and I make them crazy, I did my job. I mean, last year in Rimini, I wasn't even in my best shape, and man, I got a standing ovation. Even though I get people upset, I create controversy because controversy is exciting. And another thing, controversy motivates myself. I mean, this year I attacked Haney. You know, I didn't do it out of disrespect for Lee Haney. I did it out of the fact that I needed to motivate myself and for me to be at my best. I think you're seeing all the competitors being in top shape because, you know, I piss people off. I think I make people be at their best. I think this year at the Olympia, you're going to see the top five guys be at their absolute best condition. And I think I had a great deal to do with that this year.
Popo, get up. Crush it. Get up. Come on, Neil.
Squeeze.
Crush it.
Elbows.
Squeeze.
Elbows.
Squeeze.
Elbows. Squeeze. Come on. Watch me.
Push.
Come on, baby.
Up. Get up.
Come on. Right. Come on, baby. Up. Give me another one. Come on, baby. Come on. Up. Good boy.
Watch out. Mike tends to attribute a lot of his success to other people and so forth. Let me tell you, there's nobody like Mike Quinn. He's the most intense human being there is. His symmetry is due to his training, the way he trains, and everything else. You know.
Come on, baby, no pain. Up here. No pain. Come on, baby, no pain. No pain. Baddest in the world.
Rocket. Here we go. Let's start. Whew. Tell me when you want me. Get up. Whew. Get up.
Okay,
here's
watch.
Let's go.
Here we go.
Get up. Walk in.
Tight with elbows. Up.
Get it. Get it.
Come on, baby. No pain. One more. No pain.
Up. Get up.
Bitch. Oh.
When it comes to honing in for a competition, I don't care who you are or what you are. It's going to take you 3 or 4 tries to get it all the way down to. However, he'll be far and away the best shape of his life ever for this show. But I'll tell you what, the next show and the show after, he will be that much better always. Once you discover certain person's specifics, which we have now, believe me, these last couple of weeks have been pretty trying for both of us, then you're really able to put it together for the next one and the next one. However, he's, like I say, he'll be 100 times better than he's ever been his life, and it'll be very tough to beat.
I'm always pushing my limitations, and I think that makes me also become a role model for kids coming up. Wow, you know, he got there through hard work. I mean, I didn't get here, like, no easy road for me, you know?
Yeah, I didn't shut people down with their mouths until, you know, they're so quick to call you a has-been and blah, 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 this and that, but they have no idea what it's like. Couldn't walk a mile in my shoes.
Yeah.
No friggin' way.
At that 90 Olympia, the one you went in drug-free, you were happy with your routine. It just, felt like, you know, obviously your physique was skinnier because of no drugs.
My legs were gone.
Yeah.
You know, doing 2 hours of cardio a day.
Yeah.
My legs were gone.
Right, right.
So, again, I had the best routine in the show.
Yeah.
I mean, it was pretty cool. Sorry, I had to stretch.
That's right.
I'm an old guy.
Now, after that, was that when the WBF approached you guys to go over their organization?
Yeah, John, what you don't realize, I'm the one who started the WBF with Vince McMahon.
Really?
I was training in Boca Raton, Florida. Vince had a big mansion on the ocean.
Uh-huh.
You know, he knew who I was. So he says to me one day, what do you think about me doing my own federation? I said, well, I think if you're going to do that, you better pay the athlete. You know, pay these guys. And, you know, I got a big contract. I mean, for 2 years, I got $400,000. 2 years, you know, but you know, you weren't, you know, you were constantly being drug tested, and you know, honestly, I didn't like Vince. You know, I just did not get along with him. You know,
was that a hard decision to make, Mike, to leave the IFBB and go over to the WBF?
No, because the money. I built a Gold's Gym in Palm Beach, Florida. I sold that, made doubled my money. And I went down to Boca Raton and I bought the Gold's Gym for that area. And that gym was so awesome. Great gym. I mean, 8,000 square feet, workout floor, but I had $200,000 of equipment. I mean, I had double line of Cybex for the businessmen there, you know, that ran facing each other down the hallway.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I built the gym for me to train. You know, that's how for me to train. And that was 94 I built it. Yeah. It was great having a gym, but the story losing that gym was horrifying, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. My dad was training this guy. My personal training business, my dad ran inside the business. We were doing great. I mean, we were making like 20 grand a month. But my dad was an awesome trainer. And he had, you know, we had 8 trainers working 40 hours a week. So that's pretty much unheard of. So one day, you know, my dad's training this guy, and I'm friends with him. I say hi to him. So one day, the guy says, Mike, can I talk to you for a minute? I said, sure. Come in my office. He goes, you know, Mike, I got something to tell you. Mike, I'm an FBI agent. And I said, okay. I mean, I didn't think anything of that. Sure, there's cops and everything running around my gym.
Yeah.
Man, celebrities coming into training. My dad trained Dice Clay. My dad trained him. Talk about a funny fucker he is. And he told me that, you know, my business partner, one of them was a doctor, or actually a chiropractor, and he was a front guy for John Gotti. So I had to hear the words, John Gotti has $250,000 running through your business. So their answer to that was, well, Mike, if you testify, we'll get them all out of here. You'll own the whole gym. I remember looking at him like he had 3 heads. I was like, testify? So, you know, this is 94. John Gotti's still alive and kicking, and they're killing people still then, you know?
Yeah.
So I was like, no, I'm not, you know, going to fucking rat anybody out. And it was what it was. And then for the next 10 years after I lost my gym, I couldn't build any more gyms because it had gone all over the country that I'm mobbed up. You know, supposedly at that time the mob was involved with Mickey Rourke and me. That's when Mickey Rourke tried to be a boxer.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, joke that was, but no, they were. I couldn't open a gym for 10 years. Every time I sat down with investors, you know, I'd find a location, do a business plan, and every single time they're like, well, aren't you with the mob? So I just gave up, you know. I mean, it took me a long time to get rid of that reputation, John.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, face it. That's the worst thing you can have is a moniker. You're with the mob.
Yeah.
That sucked. I mean, that was the beginning of the end for me at that particular time in my life. And
so going back to that WBF, you were the one that talked to Vince McMahon talked about doing the new organization, huh?
Well, yeah, he asked me. I told him, John, I said, Vince, you got to pay us. You know, WIDA doesn't give us contracts. That's all the guys want is to be paid.
Yeah. Now let's meet our next competitor. He's exciting. He's brash. Sheer dynamite. And no wonder he was the very first bodybuilder to embrace the vision of the WBF. Here, ladies and gentlemen, is a dynamic look at Mighty Mike Quinn.
I've been pretty fortunate that I've never had a dumb moment in my bodybuilding career. On the stage or in the gym or pretty much any place. I get energy from the people. I get tremendous amount of energy from them, and I just, you know, everything just comes out of me. I've been very fortunate that I don't think I've ever had a quiet audience, you know, just because of my persona as far as how I've been marketed in bodybuilding as being the psycho. I've built a career based on love, you know. My parents have probably been to almost every competition I've ever been in. You know, my sisters have almost been in every competition I've been in. I couldn't do it by myself. I'm not a selfish person. I think I'm two people, two really separate people. Being a person that's on the edge, I think I like anything that has to do with speed. Anything that makes me feel like I'm getting shot out of a cannon. And there's something about that feeling your eyes being sucked into the back of your head that gives you a feeling of being on the edge. Bodybuilding's been everything to me. It's given me a very strong identity, a good self-worth. I think because of my very strong personality, I definitely am a rebel with a cause.
Yo, baby, this is the Mighty One coming at you live. Sit back and enjoy the ride, baby, because I'm going to rock you like you've never been rocked. Hear me, baby?
Great entrance. Unbelievable.
Called the psycho, he's a rebel with a cause.
But this guy is a performer. This is what it's all about.
Yeah. 1981, he was Mr. Teenage America. A decade later, he's on his way seeking the first WBF championship.
Wow. Thickly muscled back. Very thickly muscled. Yeah.
Very intense presentation. Look at the face. Every muscle taut. For anyone who doesn't know how much work goes into this, stand in front of a mirror, yeah, flex for 2 minutes, you're exhausted, absolutely spent.
He's a great double bicep Mike has. You know, Mike just compels you to watch him. He looks at the audience, and you just can't help but be lured into the Mike Quinn trip.
Original presentation. To count on him to do the unexpected, to take chances and risks. He just throws himself into his performance. and biceps like cantaloupes.
Wow.
Never stops.
Super muscled guy. Get shot. It's a very creative kind of a routine here. Mike's never done something like this before.
The resurrection of Mike Quinn.
Dancing. This is great. This is great. He's good at it, too.
Well, this is no foxtrot.
Oh, yeah. The audience loves this, I'll tell you that.
In the audience.
Oh, yeah.
In the audience, his parents, it was his father who started him in this sport as a child. They come to all his competitions. Very close with his dad.
Boy, really gets a crowd going. You just have to respond to an overtune like this. Yeah. You know, Mike's the kind of guy that can be feeling down before a routine, but he'll walk on stage, he'll light up, and you light up right with him.
He Great. Has given them his all. Brady Mike Quinn. He loves it. He owns this crowd.
And I can remember calling Jimmy Manion and asking him about it, you know.
Yeah.
Jimmy was like, pretty much, you know, Mike, you got to do what you got to do. And if they're offering you big money, then, you know, you're in this to make money.
Yeah.
So, you know, you knew it was going to fail when he drug tested everybody, except for Stridham. I mean,
now, did they drug test the first year, Mike, or was it both years?
Yeah, both years.
Both years? Okay.
Listen to this. It was horrifying for me. They'd call me like 7 o'clock in the morning, wake me out of bed, and tell me I had 35 minutes, 40 minutes to get to take my drug test, which was like 30 miles away. So I'd have to get out, you know, thank God I had a fast car. I'd have to get out of bed and fly there. I mean, literally drive 100 miles an hour to get there in time to do my
test. What kind of testing was it? Was it blood test?
Just urine.
Urine test?
Yeah, that was enough. You know, it sucked. Those 2 years, even though I made money and I built gyms, and it still, for me, competitive-wise, sucked. I didn't like being controlled.
Yeah.
Especially, you know, drug testing, which... You know, here we did. I was drug tested 1990 for the Mr. Olympia and then 91, 92 at WBF.
Right.
So those 3 years, I really wasn't on much of anything.
Yeah.
And if you remember at this time, you know, Arnold also drug tested his show.
Yeah.
If you remember.
Yeah, and
that was horrifying. I remember Arnold, you know, tapped me on the back of the shoulder and I look like a freak. I got a ponytail earrings. I got leather pants on, long leather jacket. You know, I look like a psychotic guy, and I was. And he tapped me on the shoulder. He says, oh, you know, in his accent, Mike, why didn't you go on my show? And I looked at him. I said, you know what, Arnold? Because you, like an asshole, you drug tested your show. And he didn't know what to say. Matter of fact, he never said nothing to it. You know, I said, Decadorablin takes anywhere from 12 to 16 months to clear your system.
Right.
And they decided that a year before that. So I knew I was going to fail. Why would I give them the pleasure of putting in print that I failed the drug test?
Right.
You don't see any of that anywhere. And I don't know. It sucked a little bit. It did.
Well, then you decided to go back to the IFBB in 93?
Yeah.
The champions?
I didn't have to pay a fine or any of that shit.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't, you know.
Hey, Mike, was that the year they had the – D'Amelio had the tombstones?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. What happened with that?
you know, they had a coffin for me. So,
they had tombstones for all the guys that went over to the WBF out on the stage, right?
Yeah, it was, I didn't give a shit. You know, I feel bad. I didn't have to pay no money to go back to the IFBB.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of my competitors had to pay money to come back.
Yeah, that's
what I heard. Yeah, and I knew my value at that point, John. Mm-hmm. You know, I was like, no, I'm not paying shit. You know, but come on, Joe Weed and everybody liked me. All the magazine people love me.
Yeah.
You know, you sit down, you get a real interview. I don't hold back. You get real pictures. And
didn't you crush that tombstone on stage? I remember reading it.
Yeah. Yeah. Cracked the fucker in half.
Yeah.
Only styrofoam, but still, cracked it in half and was pissy. And I didn't even place in the top 15 of that show.
I
didn't care. You know, at that point, you just, all the bullshit that's going on around you and it's constantly up and down with the drugs and everything else, I just didn't give a shit.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't give a shit until 94. You know?
So what happened in 94? You came back and you were bigger than ever in that show.
Well, I competed in the Ironman, which was the end of February. Kevin LeBron won the show. Now, ESPN only interviews me and Kevin. You know, it's like bizarre. I didn't even go in the top five. I totally blew my peak by listening to somebody saying, you know, if you drink 2 gallons of water, you'll be, you know, ripped. Yeah, bullshit. You know, I was in condition, but smooth as a baby's ass. So, that's the end of February, and I go home, and I say, you know what? I'm going to do what everybody else does. It was the second time taking growth, and like I said, I took EPO. And the drug cycle wasn't high dosages, but through a three-month period,
mm-hmm.
I was on, 27 different drugs.
Yeah.
You know, you drop one, add in another one, drop one. I mean, this was a major chemist over in Europe, but they were working with Olympic athletes, and they knew, you know, what they were doing. And I won the Night of Champions. That was in May, but do you remember 3 weeks into taking the EPO? I don't get on the scale because it's not important.
Yeah.
You know, the meter doesn't lie. And I remember getting on the scale a week before and literally having a panic attack. I was like 254 pounds. And I was in condition. I was like, wow, this is crazy.
But wow. That's nuts.
I think it hurt my heart. You know, your body's not. Excuse me, your body's not meant to put on that much muscle at one time.
Yeah, that's.
It was because I was lean and I didn't have to come down that all I had to do was put on muscle. And the drug was incredibly strong. I mean, come on, Lance Armstrong won all these, you know,
Tour de France's.
And, you know, the sad thing about that is, John, there are 200 guys that didn't get caught.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. And then, and same in baseball, okay? The Yankee guy's going to get it stuck up his ass. But, again, there's even more people in baseball that didn't get caught.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're probably talking between 200 and 300 athletes that were using stuff and, you know, beat the test.
Right.
You know, it wasn't what the thing is with that, as soon as they come out with a drug and the IOC gets a hold of the drug, then there's a molecular structure of the drug. So they can go back to all your urine tests and see that you were, you know, taking drugs.
Yeah.
I mean, come on, poor Marianne Jones. I mean, oh my God, you know, she was just doing what everybody else was doing.
Right.
But she got caught, and look at it, it ruined her life. Yeah. That never should have happened.
Right, right.
You know, Ben Johnson, when he got, you know, lost his medal, he was right. They were all taking Winstrol. They were all doing the same thing, and he got caught, you know, and everybody else didn't. So they, you know, it ruined his life. So I've never, never done something like that that's going to ruin anything about my life.
Mm-hmm.
I was, you know, I think it was the fact that I didn't care that much, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was so hard to get in shape, John, you know? It just really was, you know? It was the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. And
you think that was that the biggest you ever looked, Mike? Was that for that 94 Night of the Champions?
Oh, yeah. It was freaky.
Yeah.
I mean, it was really... really freaky. I mean, the photos I got from it, they don't look real. You know, you look at your body a certain way your whole career, and then on one day you get on stage and you're 30 pounds heavier than you've ever been. And
yeah.
It's shocking, to say the least.
What do you think about the competition? Because this is like probably 5 years after you were in the IFBB before in the Olympia. So now you're coming back, competing with the new crop of IFBB pros. What do you think about? Was it a lot of big difference with the size difference, the way everybody was?
Well, you remember Michael Francois won.
Yeah.
And NASA took second. And honestly, I should have been third. But they ended up giving me a fifth. And, I think at that point you started seeing guys get bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm assuming that other people know about Epigen that I had taken for that show. Mm-hmm. I think, everybody used it from Europe. So, yeah, it was unreal.
Hmm.
I mean, John, it was so strong that I had to stop training heavy. within a week of taking it, it felt like my insertions were going to tear from the joints.
Yeah.
Right off the bone. I mean, I had trained so light. But that can tell you how rapid my body's growing.
Right.
That your tendons and ligaments are not catching up at all.
Yeah.
And usually that's opposite. Usually your tendons and ligaments, take the brunt of everything, and then, your muscle takes over. But no, this is totally different.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, I've never been better, and I never got on stage again.
Yeah.
Yeah. And actually been competitive. Yeah, that was the last year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's it. I mean, not much more besides, the amount of fights I got into. Geez, I can't remember, John, there's been so many.
Yeah.
I mean, that wasn't something I wanted to do,
Mm-hmm. But,
I would beat up bullies and predators,
Yeah.
That's what I would, sought out when I was out in public,
Yeah.
I couldn't stand to somebody get picked on you. I would flip out.
Right.
And that all relates back to your childhood and how you grow up.
Right, right.
We develop fear from our childhood that we have right into our adult lives. I've been through it all, John. 14 years of therapy. I've been on so many different drugs to find the right combination. I don't take anything for bipolar. I mean, I've tried four different drugs. They're just too strong. They take away my edge. But when I'm under a lot of stress, like I am now, I get very bipolar. It's hard to explain, but you just, everything, you have racing thoughts, and you're internally, your clock is being wound so tight. And I don't want to take the bipolar drugs.
Right.
I've been thinking about it lately because I've had so much on my plate trying to get me back, back out there in the right way. And now it's all pretty much over now except for me teaching people.
Yeah.
That's all I want to do because I know old school works.
Right.
I don't allow my athletes to take high dosages of drugs.
Right.
I especially don't let them take insulin. I mean, I have a couple of clients say, what about taking insulin? I said, what about not working with me? You train somebody, you got to be responsible for their health.
Right.
I make my people after a show get blood work. I want to see how their liver is functioning, and their kidneys,
Yeah.
We're going to see a lot of deaths, brother.
Yeah, I know. We already are.
Yeah. Well, think about it. Mega dosages that your liver has to filter out. It filters, it throws that poison into the kidneys, and we excrete it through urine. Well, when you throw on 400 to 500 grams of protein on top of that, John, your adrenals, these guys are all going to have kidney failure.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of protein consumption is going to kill you. There's no doubt. I mean, why are these guys dying?
Right.
I mean, their hearts are giving out. It's too much strain to get that big. And, honestly, when I was 252 cut, I wasn't real comfortable, Not like I was at 220. At 220, I'm in shape.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I ran my whole life, did sprints,
Yeah.
The stairs in California that are a quarter mile straight up,
Right.
The death prepping for shows.
Right.
So I was dead serious. I was in shape when I got on stage.
Mm-hmm.
Not just looked in shape, but in shape.
Yeah.
In great condition.
Right.
I don't think I would change any of that.
Right.
I mean, that was my way of training, and you know, you don't want to get on stage and feel like you didn't do enough.
Yeah.
I always got on stage pretty exhausted and pretty much did everything I was supposed to do.
Right.
You know? But it's okay. I mean, I don't regret anything of my life. I'm kind of enjoying it now, you know?
What were some of your favorite memories on stage, Mike, in your bodybuilding career?
Well, I got to tell you, 88 was the best.
Yeah.
I don't think anything surpasses 88 as far as, you know, I mean, being on stage and knowing you're in really crazy condition.
Yeah.
The morning of the show, I woke up and I couldn't believe what I looked like.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, and like I said, I worked with a chemist. I was doing very low doses of drugs, but these drugs were made. I didn't even know what they were. I mean, I knew they were strong anabolics that didn't aromatize and make you produce estrogen. You know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I just got really, really hard rock in condition. But now they're doing it with just drugs, John, and they use some crazy drug now called DMP.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it literally cooks your brain.
Yeah.
And it brings up your core temperature over 100 degrees, 102. Well, that slowly cooks your brain over time. And how much of a moron do you got to be to do that?
Right.
I mean, please, lack of intelligence is just, I mean, one thing, we took drugs and you know they hurt you over time. They do. But it's another thing to do something like that. I'm sorry, it makes you a coward. You know, it makes you a non-competitive athlete, you know. It's all, I'm tired of it. I'm tired of the drugs.
Are there any bodybuilders out there now that really impress you, Mike?
Well, I like Kai Greene because he's the best performer I've ever seen.
Yeah.
You know? And I thought last year he should have won the Olympia, but you'll never see a bad boy win the Olympia. I don't care what Kai looks like, he's not going to beat Phil Heath. You know. And I think the guy that impresses me the most now is this new kid, Compton. I mean, yeah. I haven't seen him there. That's got to be the biggest white guy I've ever seen.
I know.
But again, it's so far off the chart. You know, when you're somebody like me and you're thinking, wow, how did I get to be that big? You know, something's up. You know, because I know how I got big, but this is a whole new dimension of drug abuse.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I'm impressed. And watching the honor last year, I wasn't very impressed. You knew Dexter was going to win no matter what condition he came in, John. Mm-hmm. And to be honest with you, he was not at his best this past one. I thought Cedric should have won the show.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he looked awesome and nice lines. And, you know, tall guy, little slender waist, he had the look.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think he's someone that they need to watch out for.
You think the sport would be improved if they brought back more of the, you know, judging more of the shape and the aesthetics and just size and condition?
Of course. Why wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Then automatically it becomes a guy that's just in great shape. That's why we were so acceptable mainstream in my era.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, a guy could look at me and be my height and say, you know what, I could probably, you know, almost get to that.
Yeah.
And it was true.
Right.
If you worked hard, took drugs, and dieted properly, you know, you could have looked like me.
Right.
You know, those kind of guys at 5'8", if you look through history, that are just monsters.
Yeah.
I mean, it's, but, no, I just, you know, I'm trying to think, but no. It's hard to, for me to think about who really impressed me. I mean, honestly, the first time I see Ronnie Coleman win the Olympia, you know, I was sitting in the third row, John, and when he turned around to mm-hmm. his back, I've never seen anything like that before.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting there feeling like I never lifted weights before.
Right.
When he came on the scene, you know?
Right.
He was the most shocking. I mean, Dorian was a shock factor, but not as much as Ronnie.
Yeah.
I mean, it was just, there's no words that can describe how I was feeling that time at that Olympia, you know? But, you know, he's a good guy, you know? He's good, but I'm telling you, my favorite is always going to be Lee Haney.
Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah, plus, he's a class act, too, you know?
Oh, my God. No, Lee's never, he's so even. You know, he's a preacher, dude. He's like,
yeah.
You know, I the first thing I ever said about him when we were younger is like, I couldn't beat him spiritually. I mean, he was just so even. with his personality and so grateful just to be alive and kicking, you know. You know, not many people get to experience that or feel that. And I always said I couldn't beat him spiritually.
Yeah.
I mean, physically, yeah. I could go at it and probably train harder than him and couldn't handle my workouts.
Right.
But that didn't mean anything. He's the full package.
Yeah.
You know? God, I remember I seen him a year ago and I remember him grabbing his son and going, hey, this is my Quinn. You know, and I was like so surprised. I mean, it was such an honor that, you know, he kind of had that respect for me.
Yeah.
You know, he knew I worked very hard.
Yeah.
I mean, most of the people in the sport knew I worked hard, but I was crazy.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. That was it. I mean, I can't get around it. I mean, I can now, John. I mean, I don't do anything. I mean, I barely go out of the house when it drives my girlfriend crazy, but.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm just that way. I'm very introverted, and, you know, I never needed the attention, John. You know, even though I got a tremendous lot of attention, you know, it wasn't what made me tick.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was seeing my family and audience when I competed, you know, taking pictures and doing autographs with fans. That was my whole thing. The rest, I just didn't care. I stopped caring very early in my career because I knew what was going to happen to me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I made a decision. I'm going to tell the truth or I'm going to be a bullshit artist and lie.
Right.
Well, I chose to tell the truth. And, you know, it's helping me now.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, it is. I mean, I wrote a book that's unreal.
Yeah, when's that book coming out, Mike?
Oh, dude, I've gone through so much bullshit with it. I just had a guy, I had it for 8 months. You know, he just bullshitted me. But I have other connections that the book is going to.
Mm-hmm.
But he just bullshitted me. You know, they said they were going to turn it into a movie. Well, it should be a movie because it's outrageous. You know, if you think about all these things I've done, I mean, fighting, you know, losing my gym to the mob. I mean, just my whole life is like not what a bodybuilder's life was.
Right.
You know, it's kind of like, you know, you're hanging around with the toughest guys. And, you know, most of my friends were criminal and, you know, hung around with a lot of mobsters in my life. And, you know, you get that reputation and it wasn't good for me. But, see, it plays big into something like writing a book, mm-hmm. you know.
Mm-hmm.
That plays big. It's a shock factor. You know, and I talk about, I don't know if you've ever dealt with this, but I talked about private posing, John.
Mm-hmm.
It drove me crazy. That drove me crazy that was in my sport.
Yeah.
I mean, I was like disgusted. And it took me about a year after I turned pro, you know, getting phone calls from people, oh, do you private pose? And I'd be screaming on the phone, I'm going to track you down and kill you, you know? I mean, it took a whole year to scare people to say, you know what, stay away from him. He's not that way. And, you know, I wrote about it in detail and, where it originated at. It originated in Arnold's Era. And, you know, why is everybody in Arnold's Era, nobody's working? You know?
Mm-hmm.
Nobody had jobs, John, so what were they doing? Mm-hmm. Think about it.
Right.
John, Dennis Tenorino did a year in jail because he was prostituting all the guys out. He did the rap for, I hate to say this, he did the rap for Arnold. He did the jail time for Arnold.
Mm-hmm.
You know? It was so crazy bad, you know, then. And that made me such more of an outcast, John, than you. The first time I go to Gold's Gym in Venice, I just won the Teenage America, and I want to go out and see how people train. So I go, and I noticed, you know, behind the counter, they got this big, thick book of bodybuilders. And I remember looking through the book thinking, what is this for? Well, what was going on is people were calling and, you know, picking who they wanted to. I mean, I'm talking like 300 people in a book.
Mm-hmm.
They called to see, you know, they wanted to order up a meal. I mean, it's not a meal, but, you know,
right.
Ordering up, I guess ordering up some fucking penis. I don't know.
Right.
But you know, I John, I hated it. And that made me much more of an outcast on top of me being a bad boy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would never do that.
Right.
I'm going to tell you, this scared me a lot. The year 2000, I'm still married. And I get a call from a doctor whose family is Shell Oil. Okay, and now he tells me, listen, Mike, I'm sponsoring like 10 of your competitors. I said, well, who are they? You know, he's paying like 100 grand a year. He says, I'll tell you when you sign a contract. And I'm thinking, I'm not thinking anything. I'm like, wow, this is really bizarre. I mean, he's not telling me. So sure enough, the conversation gets on. And my ex-wife is on the other phone. I used to tell her these things went on. She didn't believe me. And the guy told me he'll give me $100,000 to sponsor me. And then all of a sudden, he says at the end of the sentence, how often will I have access? And I was like, oh, my God. I remember looking at my wife and going, see? I said, and I told the guy, you know what? You did not do your homework on me. I'll work in a fucking Burger King before I'll ever do that.
Right.
Come on. My parents, and that's just not me. I'm old-fashioned. But it was pretty to know that 10 of my competitors he had were in contract with him, and he was basically flying around the country having sex with them. And, wow. Oh, my God. To look as good as I did, you know, who wouldn't want to be with a woman? I mean, I just don't have that way of thinking.
Right, right.
Unless we don't understand, if you're heterosexual, you don't understand what it is to be, you know, bisexual or, you know, or gay or, you know, any of that. Mm-hmm. You don't understand the thought process behind it, right. You know? And it's still big in the sport, John. This underground shit is huge.
Yeah.
I mean, with the women and everybody, these video game sessions, I think that's why the sport has not gone mainstream and it will never go mainstream.
Yeah.
Because there's too many factors. Come on, if you're a journalist, you're going to find all of this out real easy.
Yeah, for sure. You
know? So, I don't know. I think my era was the best era and bodybuilding was over.
Yeah, me too.
When my era was over.
Yeah.
I mean, we were like rock stars, John. It was hard to explain. But
right, right.
You can't imagine being in Europe and, you know, doing a session with, you know, me and Barry DeMay and whatever pro in Europe was with us and just having lines of women, you know, wanting pictures with us and take pictures with you. You're like,
right.
Wow, you talk about an ego boost.
Yeah.
But right. I always had one girlfriend at the time, and I would like to promote my personal training business.
Okay.
And you can reach me at promightymikequinn@yahoo.com.
Okay.
People want to work old school, and I'll be showing people this weekend one of my, you know, my clients what she looks like when she gets on stage. But,
okay. All right.
You know, it's not too, I'm pretty good. That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then, you know, hopefully your book will be coming out pretty soon.
Well, I've got to. Matter of fact, we're making copies of my book today, and I've got to, believe it or not, a fan out in California. He has connections to Dick Wolf, you know, who made all the Law and Order series,
right?
And another client, a friend of mine, who's called Power David, who's the strongest guy I've ever seen. Well. Long story short is he told me that, you know, he did a bodyguard job for one of Mark Wahlberg's movies,
mm-hmm.
and he was talking about bodybuilding, and actually Mark said to him, you know, Mike Quinn's from Massachusetts, is where I'm from,
mm-hmm.
so Mark has a production company, and I got the, I've got the mailing address, I'm going to send him the whole thing, and I think if anybody, that would be, Mark's from Boston.
Yeah, that'd be a great connection, yeah.
But even to do, I always thought this would be more of a documentary than a movie.
Yeah.
It's very hard to find somebody to play me.
Yeah, right.
And I don't think there's ever been a bodybuilding movie ever made. So,
right, right.
But I think it would be an amazing documentary, you know, going back to my hometown and doing it. Yeah. I mean, yeah, I would love that. But that's it. I'm plugging away, John. I'm still plugging.
All right, Mike.
I'm doing. Listen, thank you very much for having me on the show.
Thank you for being here, and we appreciate it. Listen to your whole career, and like I said, I always grew up admiring you and looking at all your shows, and I thought you were a great personality during the time, and so it was a pleasure to talk to you, Mike.
Thank you, John. I mean, it's kind of, thank God I wasn't medicated then. I probably would have been not half as much fun, right? All right, John, thank you very much.
All right,
I really appreciate it.
Thanks for joining
us
on the Bodybuilding Legend Show, buddy.
All right, thank you. Bye.
Take care.
All right, that's it for another edition of the Bodybuilding Legend Show. Thanks again to Mike Quinn for a very interesting and open interview. I really enjoyed it. On the next edition of the Bodybuilding Legend Show, we're going to be talking to the legendary Lee Haney, 8-time Mr. Olympia, considered by many to be the best bodybuilder of all time. So it was our honor to have Lee Haney on the show on the next edition of the Bodybuilding Legend Show. Join us then. Thanks, everybody.